This is Babbitt Babbage, and this is a supplementary video for the course on Nietzsche at Fordham University in the spring of 2022. Last time we met, we talked about Beyond Good and Evil, but we did not have the chance to go into the text at any detail, and part of the reason is its complexity. Now, this is not a lecture that would then do that. It is the case that to properly discuss Beyond Good and Evil, you really need an entire course on it. And that then looks backwards to what we've already been doing, reading Nietzsche's other works, and it looks forwards, to be sure, and at the same time, looking ahead to where we're going, because we are taking up the next text that he publishes along with that, and that's, we'll be talking about that, on the genealogy of morals. To that end, I'd like to share a screen. And you can see that here, reflections, kind of good and evil image, like good omens or bad omens, depending upon how you want to look at it. And exactly that is the issue, good and evil. This is, I have another image of the same thing, but a supplementary review, which is to say a repetition, at least in part, but it's not exactly that, because it's only a reprise for the sake of students who missed or who wanted to revisit the discussion of Beyond Good and Evil. It's also not, as I already said, going to be an overview of the entire book, although I will touch on portions from the very beginning and portions from the very end, but in no way is this a lecture on the text as such. Preliminary is what we could say. I have reflections behind me, but it really could be preliminary reflections. Now, the text is key, and no one, I think, no scholar denies the value of this book. No one, it's not like the Birth of Tragedy where some folks don't read it at all. In this case, it's really read. And it's not like The Will to Power, though we're gonna see there is a connection with The Will to Power. Many scholars advise against citing The Will to Power because Nietzsche never wrote it. More significantly, Nietzsche's scholarship draws on this book. Everybody cites it. But there are risks, as the analytic tendency to divide Nietzsche into early, middle, and late, as we can see, can be just a little bit misleading, just to the extent that the divisions tend not to be the same for all readers. In class, I suggested that the model could be literary. It might be musical, and one can think of the late quartets, for example, or you can think of other ways of classifying musicians, Mozart, the late Mozart, and so on. And in Nietzsche's case, the terminology could be that, but it's also a little more dangerous because it can lead us to the conviction, Überzeugung is the word that Nietzsche likes, the assumption that a philosopher's ultimate or main work might be his last, the last thing he wrote, as if there were a telos to a philosopher's life. And I'm not sure that that's accurate. There may be more organic things at work. This can also betray the rather durable conviction, it's related but it's not the same, that Nietzsche had planned an ultimate magnum opus, which typically is supposed to be The Will to Power. That's the preferred candidate. And why not? It's utter nachlass, meaning that editors can put it together any way they like, and they have, although there are also some sophisticated arguments that have been advanced on behalf of the Antichrist, or Twilight, Twilight of the Idols, or even Nietzsche's suggestively titled Ecce Homo, that's a version of this one, but differently articulated, Wie man wird, was man ist. We have here a Jugendstil sort of book plate for that. This served, of course, as a cover. On a scholarly level, the danger is that one can fail to attend to the role played by a factor, that's readerly reception or response, as this factor was very important for Nietzsche's own development as a thinker, and that is, to be sure, the role of his reception. Nietzsche complained that he lacked readers. It's something that he writes about in Ecce Homo, and that the readers he did have lacked understanding. So he didn't have readers, and the ones he had didn't get him. Okay, that's an interesting complaint. In part, this can be related to what Gadamer spoke of as Wirkungsgeschichte. In philology and hermeneutic philosophy, in English, we could call that the history of effects, which is related to what Anglophone literary scholars, they'll also speak of reception, will, however, also call influence, and which, as in the title of a famous book by Harold Bloom, elicits a certain anxiety. An issue when it comes to Nietzsche is knowing what texts Nietzsche himself was influenced by, texts he read casually, texts he studied in depth, and which thus includes questions concerning what authors he valued and what readerly trends he responded to. By definition, accounts like this remain on the surface, and part of the problem of looking for a history of effects is that we tend to project a lot. So if we want to think of Nietzsche as being influenced by Socrates, we're going to find it. That used to be popular. It's less popular today. But you can also find Aristotle, or you could find Descartes, or, and I think there's good justification for that, you could find Immanuel Kant. This, however, has to do with what you're bringing to the text, and to a certain extent, Nietzsche talks about that here. So we might remember that in the case of what we began with in class, The Birth of Tragedy, we had occasion to note the name of Wagner, which was easy because Nietzsche addresses in his preface Wagner. We also noted, and I like to emphasize this, the importance of Beethoven for Nietzsche. The connection has to be underscored, Nietzsche and Beethoven, because Wagner himself also wrote a book on Beethoven in addition to arranging the Ninth Symphony, which of course compounds the association, quite in addition to Nietzsche's frontispiece, as this testifies to Beethoven's Prometheus effect, as you could call it, as this permeates the 19th century into the transforms and new music of the 20th, such that Adorno also wrote, famously unfinished, a book on Beethoven. Beethoven may be a classical reference, but that's not to say that we understand him, and it's also not to say that we understand the role of Beethoven in Nietzsche's thinking. I think I've made some efforts in that direction. I don't think I've cracked the puzzle completely. Nietzsche, and this is part of the reason why I don't think we've fully solved the problem, tells us that his Zarathustra is to be read musically, that is, heard or read as a symphony. And Richard Strauss echoes this claim in his orchestral tone poem, Also sprach Zarathustra, so named for Nietzsche's Zarathustra, which he calls, and he's quoting Nietzsche, but this is a quote from Strauss, Richard Strauss, a symphony about a symphony. We could also add, and in class we noted, the numeric composition of the sections of Beyond Good and Evil, that is, the prejudices of the philosophers, free spirit, et cetera, they all count to 9, going down to what is noble. And consider that a reference to the Beethoven effect, as it were, at least for Nietzsche, who also favors, so the question is hardly decided, metaphors for pregnancy. He cites the human gestation period of 9 months, along with, more strikingly, the 13 months of an elephant. I guess it depends on how long it took him to write a particular book. The Hauptstücke, we have an image here, the 9 counted off, all in addition, so prejudices of philosophers, we're mostly going to be talking about that here, in addition to the preface. The free spirit, probably won't get to that too much. The religious character, there might be a second video on the second and third here. Epigrams and interludes, almost impossible, but we talked a bit about that in class on the natural history of morality, we scholars, our virtues, peoples, and fatherlands, all the way down to an after song, which evokes Zarathustrian themes. Now, Beyond Good and Evil, at this point, has multiply been translated into English, and as in the case of most translations, most of them are re translations. Here, as in the case of other of Nietzsche's writings, if one's not reading Nietzsche in German, one should compare the translations, if only to allow oneself to ask, it doesn't mean you're going to get an answer to your own question, whether the Nietzsche one prefers is really Nietzsche, or maybe you're fond of Kaufmann, or perhaps Zimmermann, or perhaps could be that you like Hallingdale or Del Caro. That's the text we're reading. We're reading the Del Caro translation. Now, the question, which translation, what's the significance of translation, is challenging, but it's also obvious with Thus Spoke or Thus Spake Zarathustra. Zarathustra is Nietzsche's most poetic work and directly precedes Beyond Good and Evil. So if you undertake to read Zarathustra as if, and that's choice, it were modeled on the Gospels, a translator is able to convey this stylistically, beginning with the title, as we can see that Thomas Common does. He's the Glaswegian who really gives the first canonic translation of Thus Spake Zarathustra, followed by, also from Glasgow, Graham Parks. And we joked in class that this image of Zarathustra is really an image of Graham and very much what he looks like, and so on. Nietzsche also says things that can strike the reader as odd or even wrong. And some translators have sought to make what Nietzsche seems to be saying make more sense. And so they do that in accord with their own convictions. Again, it's helpful to return to the German, but even there, the challenge of interpretation remains just because of the sometimes strange things that he says. And that's why we're reading him. That's why he's so very intriguing. In the case of Beyond Good and Evil and On the Genealogy of Morals, reading the translation by Adrian Del Caro, the text is Stanford University Press's best effort to date for the practical reason this would be Handhabbarkeit in the German, Handiness, that it offers the Anglophone reader the texts as Nietzsche himself composed them. The first, in this case, Beyond Good and Evil, which counts as a prelude, and he even emphasizes that, to the philosophy of the future, and the second, On the Genealogy of Morals, zur Genealogie der Moral, which is presented from the start as eine Streitschrift, kind of a battle writing, a polemic. Physical detail that the KSA volume 5, that's the illustrated one, I don't have the illustrated KSA editions. Mine are sort of just beige yellow. I don't know what color they are, kind of dark mustard yellow of the old volume. I think they're pinkish red in the interim, but this is the more handsome looking DTV editions of the De Gruyter collection of the Kritische Studienausgabe, matches pretty much volume 8. So already the difference between 5 and 8 tells you you're kind of not getting what would you might want to try to be getting, which is to say the complete 15 volume set, since it will be many, many more. And Stanford made that decision probably for publisher, always reflects some editorial concerns, but also the desire to make more money. The more books you have, the more money you make. Here, as we noted in class, and we already talked about this, so it's necessary just to talk about it one more time, a little talk on the covers. If we contrast three books, just three of them that we have here, I have a kind of more beat up version of what you see there with the Kaufmann, a graphic modernist block cover of the 66 Random House translation, which matches, it just so happens, the Gay Science graphic cover, not the same color, but the graphic schema, which one can compare with Reg Hollingdale's 1973 Penguin edition and Del Caro's 2014 edition with the boilerplate SUP, Stanford University Press cover. Between cover editions, Hollingdale arguably wins with its image taken from the painter Franz von Stuck, you see him here, in his illustration of the Sphinx, circa 1904 when it was painted, his Orpheus, I'm fond of von Stuck, appears on the cover of the Hallelujah Effect, also the little Egyptian animals that go along with Orpheus. And it's maybe worth considering, there is a PDF available on Blackboard for a sustained discussion of Nietzsche and Beethoven. The von Stuck Sphinx detail, you see here the foreshortening, is relevant when talking Nietzsche and a woman, a kind of proto-Vargas girl, that is soft porn, racy for cover, you could say, but not, interestingly enough, back in 1973, which was 5 years after the official date of the sexual revolution, as people like to imagine it, in 1968, but which took place a little earlier, as Ivan Illich actually quotes Philip Larkin in Illich's In the Vineyard of the Text. It's buried in a footnote. I have it here. Sexual intercourse began in 1963, which was rather late for me, between the end of the Chatterley Ban and the Beatles' first LP. That, as you can see, appears in Larkin's High Windows. In spite of the various printed versions of the text, Kaufman reminds us that it's rarely been reprinted as Nietzsche himself, first published Beyond Good and Evil in 1886. This version, as Nietzsche first published it, without editor's changes and additions and such like, is what Karl Lagerfeld had planned for his Nietzsche edition, which he didn't finish. He did begin it, but death sort of interrupted that. And that means that for the most part, when you, whether you're reading German or whether you're reading English, you're pretty much not reading what Nietzsche intended. Now, the text we are reading includes a translation of Giorgio Colli's afterword, which should be read as an index to the influence of Wiltzer Macht. That's the doctrine or dogma of will to power in pre and post-war German Nietzsche reception. Now, one should remember that the KSA appears in 1980. That's when it's printed. Barely a decade before the reunification of Germany, which remains significant for Nietzsche studies, as Weimar, where the Goethe-Schiller archives they're the ones that hold the manuscript. The Nietzsche archive doesn't really have any manuscripts to speak of. It serves as an, if you like, museum or a convenient place for Nietzsche scholars to stay and to think. Some Nietzsche thinkers sometimes show up there. And here you see Harry van der Velde's wonderful Jugendstil interior architecture. And there, right there, that is the porch where Nietzsche himself would sit and look at the Weimar afternoon in the years he spent. He died here in this Jugendstil villa, as we see. Now, the manuscripts, which had originally been here before they were transported to the Goethe-Schiller archives, hold also Goethe-Schiller and a number of other resources. And that was also the location, we mentioned that briefly in class, where terrible losses, library losses occurred. The whole reflection on loss and repression, shifting of archives, locations, celebrations, non-celebrations, reminds us that Nietzsche was canceled long before today's cancel culture. So while we're calling for other philosophers to be canceled, we might remember that Nietzsche himself was among them. Thus, two scholars, Giorgio Colli and Mazzino Montanari, this is in Socio Giamatta's discussion of their relationship to Nietzsche, came to preside over the canonic edition of Nietzsche's published and unpublished writing. The translator, Adrian Del Caro, gives us his own afterword, including an important reflection on the relation of Beyond Good and Evil, which was published in 86, and on the genealogy of morals, published a year later in 1887, to Zarathustra, which text we also already looked at in the Cambridge University Press translation. Let's recall that Zarathustra was published not quite as Del Caro writes, in four parts. It wasn't published in four parts. It was certainly written in four parts between 1883 and 1885, as the fourth book of Zarathustra was privately printed and distributed to friends. So we can maybe understand that better today, given that we unsend email and given also, unfortunately, data scrubbing, where certain facts are simply taken out of the research record, that Nietzsche would try, as he did, to retrieve all the private copies he had sent to his friends, and then, as we see, publish only three books, parts 1 to 3, 1884. He doesn't, in the time that he remains compos mantis, that is to say, until 1889, in those 5 years, he does not undertake, even though he wanted to get as many publications as he could, but he does not publish parts 1 to 4. That would only be done after his breakdown, and that would be thus done by his sister and of course, with his mother's approval. Notice the title, Also sprach Zarathustra, ein Buch für allen keinen in drei Teilen. So a book for everyone and no one, all and none, in three parts. So the musical reference is also still there. So the last page, the back matter for the text that we are reading, Beyond Good and Evil, at least in the German, we would read that the fourth part had been written at the start of 1885, but not yet released to the book trade. That's emphatically underlined. Publication history is part of source scholarship, and all of it is hermeneutically essential to understanding the text in context. We've got here an image of the 1886 cover by Naumann in Leipzig, and the preface tells us that it was composed in the date that we've seen, in June of 1885. The Vorrede, which is where that date is appended at the end, begins, supposing truth is a woman. What then? The continuation, notice the thought slash, are there not grounds for the suspicion that all philosophers, insofar as they were dogmatists, have been very inexpert about woman? Now, the image of woman as truth is old. It's not Nietzsche's coin, although he's very, very fond of it. That's certainly true. Yes, we read in the Gay Science, life is a woman. There's the Greek goddess Aletheia. There's the Roman version of the Satan, the Veritas. And there's also metonymic play, as we may be reminded, and this is also going to be helpful to us to try to understand the reference to ears and the ass, so we do rather need this, a painterly allegory. And there are a lot of these paintings, these allegorical paintings of just the same theme. If we note Botticelli's Calumny after Apelles, 1494 to 1495. You can see that if you get to Italy in the Uffizi Gallery. Now there's looking very, very much like the Venus image that is usually associated with Botticelli. There is Aphrodite, there is the naked truth, unadorned, unclothed. What's significant? If you look apart from the naked truth, it's rather very, very much an afterthought, because everything seems to be going on in the rest of the painting, with the central figure right there on the bottom of the victim himself, generic, laid low, in the lowest portion of this, which Botticelli tells us is a version of the ancient Greek painter Apelles, his allegory, his painting. So Lucian of Samosata, very important for Nietzsche, tells us the tale. Calumny is the art of besmirching. The allegory is painted or sketched by several artists, not just Botticelli. And it's said to be pointed against this king, is Midas, of course, King Midas, and his gullibility. You've got to notice his long ears. Now, if you pay attention, they're very furry, right? That these are the ears of an ass, very significant. And they're pulled by the two ladies on either side, ignorance and suspicion. These are allegorical figures with names for particular traits, in this case, particular vices. The king, Midas, extends his hand to slander, escorted by envy, as we can see if we go back to that. And if you consider this will be envy himself, who's is Gutter on his arm and egged on by these two other figures, Treachery and Deceit. Now, the black garbed woman that we see, the older woman there, because these things tend to come late in life, is Repentance. There are other depictions. There's our fairy ears one more time of King Midas. You see also the ears in the same way in Federico Zuccaro. That's circa 1569. It's unclear, goes on a little bit to 1772. And you can see that envy here, little snake-like, is involved in torturing or reducing. And of course, in this case, you've got the same naked truth, just a little more modest, however, in Giorgio Righi's Calumny of Apelles, that's later, 1560, but earlier than Zuccaro, the Zuccaro image. Okay, there we are. But here again, the ears, one more time, very, very grand. Asses or donkeys' ears, very, very large, and a very modest truth. Here she is in the clouds. You can see that in the Metropolitan. Girolamo Mozzato, also the spot circa the same time, 1500, helpfully labels, very, very nice, all of the figures so that we know who they are. And this is a terribly innocent and also very, very small victim. But we also see the ears in this etching, also clearly indicated for Midas. Now, these are all personages, illusions, dialogue, and we also happen to have two of these sketches, as it were, by Raphael, also the Naked Truth, also the poor victim, and so on. And you can say, why is it Raphael likewise? Why would there be so many of these? And part of the reason, of course, is that Apelles was, according to Lucian, himself the victim of calumny. He, the painter, was the victim, and he painted this painting in order to provide an absolute and patent rebuke to the king who had listened to the calumny, who had listened to the besmirching of his character, and therefore adding these ears to the king, he also takes his revenge. So it's a bit of kind of a violent matter. We've already met Midas. That's a very interesting thing. We've seen him with the long ears, and if this painting isn't cancelled yet, because it's in the Hermitage, it's a copy to a certain extent. It's not original, but we remember Midas because he was the one who tortured Silenus in The Birth of Tragedy. And in 1670, that painting is a painting of the judgment of Midas by an unknown Flemish artist who was himself imitating another Flemish artist. So as I say, a copy of a copy. Hendrik von Balen was the style that's being represented. Nietzsche also uses the metaphor of long ears, and that's really why we need to pay attention to this in Zarathustra, in nothing less conspicuous a locus than the section entitled, this is the fourth book, A Conversation with the Kings, Gespräch mit den Königen, where Zarathustra tells us that he had long ago unlearned how to take consideration or care about long ears, to the interruption, which is why he never finished the sentence, of the ass, who says clearly and with bad intent, bösem Wille, evil will, And ea is an interesting word because that's a great deal of debate among the philologists. Does that give us a German articulation of the way asses bray, or is that a Greek articulation? And it turns out that there's an argument on either side. We also get the same image in Von Höhen Mansion. Also, there's our Midas with his ears once again, where Nietzsche reflects that some things aren't meant for those with long ears, right? So if you've got long ears, you're someone who's listening to things that you shouldn't be listening to, and you're someone who's swayed in ways that you shouldn't be swayed. And you can remember, of course, that Plato's Republic and the long training of the auxiliaries is precisely dedicated to distinguishing the ones whose ears can be bent in this way from those who can perhaps maintain their convictions. Nietzsche's word, conviction, again. We also get the image in the Erweckung. Here we have Jourdain's Apollo as victor over Pan, and our Midas, there he is, he's kind of always in the picture. Once again, crowned by Tmolus for his victory over Marsyas, it won't end well, he will be skinned alive by the god. And there again, our King Cole-like Midas off to the ride. The caution in Zarathustra's De Erweckung is Dionysus teasing Ariadne, asking her, we can read again in this case from the magician, from Zarathustra, be clever, Ariadne, you have small ears, you have my ears. Now, when he teases her, he asks in Streifzüge eines Unzeitgemäßen, in the twilight of the idols on the beautiful and the ugly, she enters into a little dialogue with him with in response to this whole set of questions. Why do you make fun of my ears? Well, why aren't they a little longer? Dionysus asks. And we keep her in mind because she's connected, beginning with the first untimely meditation with the labyrinth, and that's of course Theseus, and who abandons her on Naxos so that Dionysus comes to her. And she's mentioned also at the end. I said we would get to the end a little bit. Here's the reference just to the Benvenuti's wonderful painting of Dionysus and Ariadne, and you see the gesture of silence so as not to disturb her little ears. He's also going to let her sleep. And the question here, Dionysus, divine, why are you pulling on my ears? Ariadne asks by one of their famous intimate conversations on Naxos from her philosophical lover. I find a kind of humor in your ears, Ariadne. Why are they not even or a little longer? At the end, that was the passage we wanted to get to. We read Beyond Good and Evil 2.9-5, under certain circumstances, I love what is human. And with this, he alluded to Ariadne, who was present. So she's the exception. The human being is, to my mind, an agreeable, courageous, inventive animal. There's no equal on earth. It finds its way in any labyrinth. Obviously, also a reference to Ariadne. I'm well disposed towards him. I often reflect how I might yet advance him and make him stronger, more evil, and more profound than he is. Now, the ironic, it's very ironic, or satirical element is patent, as in the case of the allegory itself, including long ears, pulling on them and what you like. In addition, and this is on the level of rhetoric, the image we saw in the Botticelli painting and the contrast between the woman, the ideal of truth as naked, the naked truth, is contrasted with the decorated truth or the decked out representation of truth with elaborate clothing. That can also be used and has been used as a metaphor for arranging the facts, clothing the facts, a theme of some dedication in the literature of the philosophy of science, where one also can speak, and it is a related motif, of the furniture of the world, thus embroidering the truth, masking or concealing it, and everything in the tangled web of lies needed to destroy. We can think of Othello, the good name of others, and that's, of course, again, the reference to Calumny and Botticelli. Nietzsche's phrasing, supposing truth is a woman, has been inspiring. We can know Jacques Derrida's Spurs. There's a version of this, to be sure, in Allison's The New Nietzsche. So you actually have a copy of this, if you wanted, already available to you on Blackboard, as well as just to stay with images, because Derrida is talking style or rhetoric, but as he says, his subject will be woman, a number of artists who were influenced by Nietzsche. This is Jean-Léon Gérôme, La Vérité, and that's 10 years after Beyond Good and Evil, so he's clearly referring to her, and it's clearly overdeterminedly a reference, as I've said, because here's the title, La Vérité sur temps d'un puits, armée d'un fouet pour punir l'humanité. So she's armed with the scourge. There's the scourge. It's a little dark, but you can see that. And it's obviously to punish humanity. Complete with a scourge, Nietzsche's whip, that's the motif of woman as truth, along with the remonstration in Zarathustra, not to forget the whip from Old and Young Woman or the Second Dancing Song. Like most of Nietzsche's prefaces, there's a lot involved. This is a list of the prefaces, the new ones that he wrote in this magic year of 1886, beginning in the spring in Nice, a new preface for Human All Too Human. Also, Daybreak, Morgan wrote in the fall, in Ruta near Genoa in Italy, and Die Fröhliche Wissenschaft, also the same place and at the same time, where he adds the Songs of Prince Free as a Bird and the preface to the second edition, as well as his reissuing of The Birth of Tragedy or Hellenism and Pessimism, along with an attempt at a self-critique, in addition to the publication that would be Beyond Good and Evil in 1886. So this was a year of constant publication. Now, that's informative for lots of reasons, but also for the life historical real world fact that this would have been part of a strategy of republication, because very technically, very practically, Nietzsche's Basel pension had been slated to expire after 6 years. He just got 6 years of pension. Thus, intending to support himself as an author, Nietzsche intended to issue new editions of his books, starting with writing them beginning in 1885. So, for example, you can take a look at the same list of things also included in Friedrich Nietzsche, Ecce Auctor. Klaus Otto Scheier is the editor who put together these prefaces published in 1990 with Felix Meiner. Now, Nietzsche continues the motif of truth with the first aphorism of the first section of the book on the prejudices, Die Vorurteile der Philosophen, the prejudices of the philosophers, emphasizing the will to truth as what the will, this is how he unpacks it, not to be deceived. The connection continues the prefatory association of truth and woman, thus with the temptation such that the desire for truth can be seen to be like any desire, very relevant to Sigmund Freud, who also read Beyond Good and Evil and was inspired by Nietzsche, who asks what, very much at the beginning, really is it in us that wants the truth? Nietzsche carries the erotic resonance of the question to the issue of questioning as such, reminding us, cognizant of the Sphinx, who's very clearly a little bit of a threat, and that means also of Oedipus, that's the reference, that's the figure he invokes, mindful as he might have been, this is 1864, of Gustave Courbet's Oedipus and the Sphinx. Now, if you look at this larger version of this painting, you can see the hands and the feet at the bottom. That would be the vanquished who attempted the task and failed prior to Oedipus who succeeded. This is the same Oedipus, very important for Nietzsche, who searched himself, as he tells us, who took counsel from no one. So we may remember, we talked about this, that in 1887, a year later, Nietzsche's reedition of The Gay Science, which is the one that includes the 1886 preface to the second edition, also has a new motto dedicated to the ideal, which is the Oedipus ideal of not taking counsel from anyone. I live in my own house and I've never copied anyone. I've never followed anyone. The point is parodic. The point is meant to be satirical or absurd. How can you avoid copying? How can you avoid being influenced? And we recall in the case of Oedipus that after winning his fortune by vanquishing his father, anonymously he didn't know what he was doing on the road, dispatching the Sphinx, he did know what he was doing, answering her unanswerable question, and thus attaining in Thebes a kingship by taking her out, which he'd given up. He was supposed to be a king, but he was afraid that he would murder his father and marry his mother, so he left. He was those, however, were his adoptive parents, and ta-da, he got himself to Thebes and therefore got himself a slightly used queen, his mother, unbeknownst again to himself, and was gifted with two sons and two daughters, you could say, full success in life. But he finally found his own fatal answer to the question, who really is it here who questions us? Now, for his painterly part of influence, and this is the whole question of copying and following, Courbet draws on Ingres, Jean-Auguste Dominique Ingres, Oedipus and the Sphinx, 1864, but that itself was a theme that Ingres had been working on for some time, starting in 1808 and repeated in 1827, for example, so that by the time we get to this image, he's copying his own images. Oedipus is clearly uncanny. And Nietzsche asks, if the question concerning the problem of the value of truth is coming to us, or if, as he challenges us to wonder, if it's not we ourselves who, like Oedipus, unknowingly stepped before this problem, which of us, he asks, is Oedipus here? Which of us is the Sphinx, you could say? You could add the is. Now, this is Moreau, Sphinx in a Grotto, and I encourage you to check it out. It's in the Metropolitan Museum of Art, just because blue wings are a thing. The context of the first section on the prejudices of the philosophers recalls the preface with its famous line that we really can hardly exhaust. Suppose the truth is a woman. There's a great deal of continuity then, beginning with the provocation, because this is a given. This isn't a claim he makes. This is a given that is to be supposed. He wants you to give him this in advance. Grant me this, which is what the term means for Ausgesetzt. Supposing truth to be a woman, no small amount of misogynist winking and presumption, and no less feminist preening, because in class we had some excellent questions on which were articulated in this respect. Maybe this is, could it be, a feminist text, and that's something worth exploring. We'll take this up, but it's complicated. For now, it's essential to underscore both the misogyny and the feminist rereading of this. Both are reactions. So just to follow the phenomenological tactic that can be useful in reading Nietzsche, the suggestion here is presented, that's why it's in bold, qua assumed point of departure. And to that extent, it tells us less about the femininity or womanliness of truth per se, in spite of the status of Aletheia as a female deity, as already noted, than the very masculinity of its seekers. Philosophers then, as now, continue for the most part to be male. So Nietzsche's contention that truth be regarded as a woman, and if we assume that, then what follows, leaves us little choice. His text goes on to emphasize that at stake is the old Platonic context between truth, that's woman, and doxa. To this extent, the issue here concerns the suitors of truth, the references still Platonic to the Republic and the Euthydemus and the difference between philosophers and philosophasters, all philosophers we hear, when they've been dogmatists. That is, when they seek to claim the truth, whereby the characteristic prerogative of the dogmatist is very much the claim to already have the truth. So it's not, one's not in love with it. One thinks one is already in possession of it. To that extent, it's displaying little or nothing of the way to win, that is to love or else to seduce the truth. And for the same reason, philosophers, as they're regarded, aren't lovers. And to a man, truth suitors to date are all too clumsy, as Nietzsche says. Now, will it be different with women philosophers? That was the question that was brilliantly asked in class. What if we assume that the philosopher herself is a woman? There's unfortunately no justification to assume that things will be different unless she, just like the male philosopher, is a lover, because love is crucial to the distinction between philosopher and dogmatist. What follows, as we continue to read, refers to the same question regarding the problem of the value of truth, which, of course, is Nietzsche's question. So, who of us is Oedipus here? Who, the Sphinx, the continuation? It's a rendezvous, it seems, of questions and question marks. If we keep the connection with woman, and I think we should, we might be advised to take the challenge back to reflect on the clever brilliance of the questioner. That would be Oedipus, the one, as Herdeline tells us, who has an eye too many. Tragically speaking, the one who, we remember, takes no counsel. He consults no one. Otherwise, he might have found out that his parents were adoptive parents in Corinth. So an epic metonymic connection, which is what Nietzsche sets up with Odysseus, who likewise counts as clever. If the philosopher can be compared to Oedipus, as Nietzsche does in The Birth of Tragedy, he might also be considered on the model of Odysseus here, and that's what he does in Beyond Good and Evil. The relevance of woman is also a compounding, complicating issue. Why? Because Odysseus's success requires a consort's loyalty rather than simply being able still, as we say, still, to draw his bow. The test of manhood, of being the man he is and being able to return home, lies in a woman's prudence. That's Penelope's prudence, not the achievement of masculinity or vanquishing or even seduction. It's woman's prudence that permits Odysseus's homecoming, he comes home way late, to be rewarded. Odysseus, as we know, barely recognizes the place when he's finally returned home. He doesn't actually get there. He never finds it. Even after 20 years of wandering, he's brought by a fabulous magical transport from the mythic Scheria to Ithaca, such that it's not his own seagoing prowess that brings him back home, whereby Odysseus then, after figuring out where he is, has to determine, hiding behind a mask, what challenges he faces, and only then does he get the chance to see if he can still draw his bow. All this effort is possible because of the one waiting, resourceful as Penelope is. You see the boat that he's coming back in, that's that magic boat, weaving, unweaving, waiting for his return. This way, Odysseus and Oedipus, and thereby the epic poet Homer, that's Odysseus, and the tragedian Sophocles, who writes about Oedipus, both of them frame Nietzsche's Beyond Good and Evil. To the same extent, the project of Beyond Good and Evil is more than a moral reflection, good evil, as you might assume from the title, but a politically practical endeavor. Look at the scope of the bits that we're not going to be talking about, the scope of the parts. Moving from the first section on the philosopher's prejudices to the penultimate aphorism, and that's really also sets up where we're going with the genealogy of morals, what is noble. Here I'm looking at B on Good and Evil 295. We reflect on the question, that's Nietzsche's, I think, very complicated question concerning the genius of the heart. This is, I think, an extraordinary nested sentence if you go read it, and it leads up to that great concealed one. What he means by that, he's talking about a tempter god. The phrasing is old, and one can trace it back, the language of the genius of the heart, to St. Augustine, though also more proximately in Prud'homme's aphoristic definition of tenderness, that's in German, die Zärtlichkeit, as in terms of Genie des Herzens, but even more so in the 18th century theologian also associated with this phrase, Johann Caspar Levater, and his formulaic invocation, again, of the genius of the heart. The final aphorism emphasizes the vulnerability of expression, literary communication, the philological fate of what is written. Nietzsche writes, we immortalize what cannot live and fly much longer. These are dying things. Only weary and mellow thoughts. This means, that's 296, that one might read Beyond Good and Evil in dialogue with the gay science, and the reflection there, as Nietzsche writes, a little bragging, I think, addressed to his friends that he dared to paint his thoughts on the wall, where here he reflects, it's also a Goethean reflection, we mandarins with Chinese brushes, we immortalizers of things that can be written. By definition, these are, think of Barclay Peabody's reference to classical philology, The Winged Word is the name of his book. Words that, birds that one can catch, will be birds that grew weary of flying and flew astray and now can be caught by hand, our hand. At the same time, Nietzsche reflects, this is a point to be heard already in his first book, it's a reference to Prometheus and Goethe. In several respects, all the gods could learn from us humans. We humans are more human-like. Here, Nietzsche's use of punctuation could seem to reach a peak. We've got a thought slash here, followed by, and this is the key notion, an ellipsis, which brackets then an intensifier, a mention, wir Menschen sind menschlicher. Here we catch the reference to the theological conventions of deformity, being in the image and likeness of God. Nietzsche recalls the tendency inherent in philosophic as in mathematical, technological, and scientific accounts of nature, as we went over these in the Gay Science, as an attempt there, as he says, to humanize things as faithfully as possible. By contrast, Nietzsche's proposition is that we learn to naturalize humanity in terms, he says, of a pure, newly discovered, newly redeemed nature. Now, analytic philosophers tend to be in love with naturalism, and so they find it hard to resist the idea of Nietzsche using their terms, naturalize, a term that he would have been using before it was invented, which is a terrible but irresistible solecism. We also paid attention in class to the vision of the human, as Nietzsche celebrates this in the Gay Science aphorism, where he speaks of the humaneness, as he says, of the best future. So this is a book, a prelude to a philosophy of the future, so we might want to connect that with this, articulated in terms of the happiness of a god full of power and love, full of tears and laughter. That's Gay Science 337, and you might want to read Aer Lingus or Henri Bureau for that matter. Here, we can also recall the importunity, impropriety, and seductive appeal of a possibly infinite knowledge of the scientific knowing project, and note that it's a mark of Nietzsche's sobriety that instead he proposes to humanize all sciences as far as possible, as he says, not as a Laplacian or naively positivistic schema or as a Darwinian ideal, but ironically, as he reminds us, deliberately specifying that he advocates such a mathematical ideal, not merely, as he writes, in terms of the absurdity of reducing everything to an image, our image. And thus, the project is not to know things, but in order to determine our human relation to things. Mathematics, and this needs to be read and thought about, is merely the means for the general and ultimate knowledge of the human. So mathematics is something that we can conjure or conceive, and it is something that tells us not about nature, but about ourselves. This proportionately naturalizing or humanly apportioned or measured project is reprised in Beyond Good and Evil, where Nietzsche writes that his own goal remains the same transcriptive ideal as that first advocated as the gay or musician's science. And again, we see why we set these two names, I just mentioned them, Oedipus and Odysseus together, because Nietzsche sets Oedipus and Odysseus together with his eyes blinded, right? Very strange notion here, alongside Odysseus, who commands his crew to stuff their own ears, but maybe also deafens himself. Nietzsche's language to translate the human back into nature to master the many vain and fanciful interpretations and secondary meanings which have been hitherto scribbled and daubed over that eternal basic text, homo natura, to confront humanity henceforth with the human in the way in which, hardened by the discipline of science, the human today confronts the rest of nature with dauntless Oedipus eyes. Very interesting phrasing. And stopped up Odysseus' ears, deaf to the siren songs of old metaphysical birdcatcher who have all too long been piping to him, you are more, you are higher, you are of a different origin. Now, there's an entire discussion needed to unpack this, but I think we can begin to see what's going on. And here, once again, we consider, having noted the prejudices, what we might do in a second video, assuming we get to it, on the prejudices of the philosophers one more time. I'm going to stop here. Thank you for your attention.